Hi friends, this is Raj again from Christ's Words First Ministries from California, and today I'll be sharing with you something so important but which is often not discussed in the churches, and it is from the Bible. It is straight from the Lord's words, actually from Father God and then Christ Jesus. It was a very important message, which is, you can say, you will get what you give in this world, to the world rather, and to the people. This is what you're going to get on the last day. Nothing else was the message. Nothing is going to happen. The death of Christ is imputed. The word grace was never used by Jesus. He never used the word grace, that he was being saved by grace through faith alone, in Christ alone, you know, that sola fide doctrine, which Paul taught, and my previous videos are full of them. I don't want to go into all that. Sola fide doctrine says this, that you have been saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. Jesus completely rejected that. He taught us something vastly different. And off the back, I will say, he taught us loving compassion. If anything saves, only that. And why is it that only loving compassion, kindness, acts of loving kindness will save us on the last day? How do we know that we will go through the message and you will understand it in a jiffy by the end of the message? Only loving kindness will save you, nothing else. You know, guys, why? Because God is neutral, says the Bible. He is impartial and he is just. You know who will judge us? Us. He will be judging us. Now you will say that this man is talking nonsense. No, I'm not. All this is through very hard and diligent work of years and years gathering Christ's words, basically Father God's words, and the remaining teachers and the writers. It's all about you will get what you give. So I will be reading out one after the other, many verses, to make sure you get the point, guys. This is very, very important. This could be the most important video you've ever seen on Christian faith. And the Christian faith revolved around loving compassion, forgiveness, kindness, generosity, truth. All these are offshoots of what? The tree of love, tree of compassion. That is what Jesus came to teach. He was the Messiah. He had come to teach us, give us the message. He taught us that the law cannot be destroyed. But he had come to teach us to fulfill the law, which the churches did not teach you. It's in Matthew 5, 17 and 18. Matthew 5, 17 and 18 clearly states, Jesus Christ says that I have not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. He says very clearly, the whole law, not a bit, not a tittle, not a jot, nothing can go. The world can crash and burn. The universe can be doomed, but the law of God remains. It cannot go. The only way to fulfill it, he taught us, was in Matthew 22:37-40. Love Father God with all your heart, might and soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. What does he say? When you love them, both the fellow human being and Father God himself, you obey the entire law and the teachings of the prophets. Not only the law, but the teachings of the prophets. You honor them. How? Loving God, loving the fellow human being. This was the core message of Bible. Why did he teach us love? Because on the last day, those who learn to love will be shown love. The word for it in the Hindi word, the Sanskrit word for it, is karuna. It's a beautiful word which captures the whole teaching of Bible in one word. Karuna means loving compassion. And this is what Jesus taught. On the last day, on the day of judgment, and this is in Matthew 25:31-46. Very clearly it is spelled out. It's called the future vision of the sheep and goats. The judgment day when Jesus is giving himself. This is going to happen, guys. Nobody in this world, universe can change it. Look at Matthew 28:18-20. All authority has been given, the Great Commission, to the Lord Jesus. When he says it's going to happen, whether you accept it or deny it, it's yet going to happen. What happens on that day? It divides every person, human being, whether it's Christian or otherwise, according to what they've done, not by their faith. Paul's theory of, and the church's theory of, or the doctrine of, saved by faith alone, falls flat on its face. Remember that. Whoever teaches you is lying, not because they wanted to deceive you, but they got deceived and in turn deceiving you. Tell them what happened on the judgment day. Sheep and the goat vision. It's a vision. It's not a parable. It's going to happen. An event waiting to happen. Where Jesus will be sitting on the judgment chair and will be standing alone, one on one. And he'll divide. Come here, you. Come here and go there. Like one is sheep. Division will take place. Group of sheep. These are the ones who practice loving compassion. They had acts of loving compassion, not just faith. Jesus was not interested in faith. Go back to the parable of the Good Samaritan, friends. Who was Good Samaritan? He was a part pagan. He was not a believer. He was an idol worshipper. But he had compassion in his heart. He showed compassion to a dying man on the street who he did not know, a stranger. He picks him up, puts him on his donkey, takes him to the hospital, to an inn, gets him medical treatment, and gets him back on his feet, heals him, gets him healed. This man caught the heart of Christ. He was not a believer. So don't get deceived, my friends. On the last day, it's your own self. Your face, the man in the mirror, is going to come out. It's going to be a holographic image of yours coming out. And that man or woman, which is us, will spell out what we did and whether we deserve to be saved or not. Saved, salvation is a very broad term. Now I will be reading out a lot of verses of Christ Jesus, Father God, and other prophets, by which you can conclude and will come to understand that it's all going to happen according to what you've done and what I have done. That's why Jesus kept on saying, practice loving compassion. Why? So that you also receive loving compassion. Coming back to the vision of sheep and goats, the sheep practiced loving compassion. They had acts, works. It was purely by acts and works of loving compassion Jesus left them. Come, for you who my heaven is prepared, he says that. It was always only for those, give me the goosebumps, who will practice loving compassion in their lifetime. You have a golden chance, friends, even now. If you're not, turn away from sin. That is the foremost thing, to acknowledge that we cannot live in sin. It is going to kill us, decimate us on the last day. Turn away from sin and turn to acts of loving compassion. Show compassion to people. Show love. That doesn't mean go and hug everybody and tell them I love you. No. Operate, exist from the premise of love. Love. And practice compassion on people. If you have some money and you can afford to give it without hurting your own existence and finances, do it. Do it today. Give something. Hear it. If you can't afford, share a smile. How much effort does that take? Be kind with your words, because the words are going to finally, the word says that what we speak, what we do is finally going to get us on the last day, one way or the other. And the proof again and again and again is of the judgment day vision Jesus was nice enough to give us. He may not have given, but he did. Did anybody teach you? Can this be removed from the Bible? Does Paul's words... Paul was a deceiver. I don't want to waste this episode on Paul. He had come with the express purpose to deceive, and he deceived so well. Not everybody. Now you know the deception. Check out my previous videos. I'll be planting a link. He was a deceiver, and he says with his own mouth. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 12 verse 16, be that as it may, I did not burden you with myself. Nevertheless, the crafty fellow that I am, I took you in by deception. This is Paul making a confession in 2 Corinthians 12 verse 16. So if we are going to accept everything Paul says, and we have put him and made him the Christ of our church, the Christian church, because it's his teaching, doctrine of saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, which rules the roost, so to speak, which is the benchmark of Christian salvation taught for last 500 years at least, from Martin Luther and those people, kind of people who assured in this, that we are saved by faith alone, in Christ alone, not by works. It's from Ephesians 2. It's from Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, which says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourself, it is the gift of God, not by works." Not by works, so that no one can boast. So he taught grace, which Jesus never taught. Why didn't Jesus teach grace? Even after his resurrection, when he came back and spent time with disciples and others, why did he not teach grace? He taught millions, sometimes 10,000 at a go, even more. Why didn't he teach, "You've been saved by grace"? Did he even use the word grace? No. All he taught, again coming back to, I don't want to spend time on Paul, irritates me. He has deceived us all, and he has acknowledged his deception in 2 Corinthians 12 verse 16, that a crafty fellow that he is, he took in the church of Christ by deception, he says. Now let's sweep aside Paul and his deception. What did Jesus, the Savior, teach? He taught karuna, loving compassion. Why? Why did he teach love? In Matthew 22, 37, 40, let's read it together, friends. Jesus says in Matthew 22, 37 to 40, "Love the Lord, your God, with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. And the second one is like this: love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." Now he repeats this in Matthew 7, 12, what is known as the golden rule: do to others as you would want them to do to you. And again he says the entire law and the prophets are fulfilled by this. What do you want others to do to you, friends? I want them to love and respect me. That's what Jesus is teaching. Love everybody. Why? Because on the last day, that is all that will matter. What did you do? Why did God put it like this? See, this is a very difficult sermon. Grace of God, His Holy Spirit, which is speaking through my mouth today, we will try to accomplish and connect the dots. Why did Jesus teach karuna, loving compassion? Because on the last day, those who practice loving compassion, as it is shown in Matthew 25, 31 to 46, that's a future vision of goats and the sheep parable, or vision rather, where people will be divided based on what they did. Those who practice loving compassion were saved, and the others, the goats, who didn't practice loving compassion, who just had faith, they were Christians with just faith alone, Paulian Christians, I call them Paulians, faith alone. Jesus says, "I don't want you." He rejected them with harsh words of condemnation. Read that, friends, you will understand that. But it is important right now to understand the whole universe and its laws. The world is like a high-tech maze. Now we understand better because of the genius of these software people and the technology which is now makes us understand. It is a high-tech maze. Everything we are doing is getting recorded. It says in the Bible that everything you do will be, the Lord searches your heart and will be exposed on the last day. Let me read that out. But let me go back to that point I was making lest I lose. It's a track of that. It's a very high-tech maze God has created. He's the brilliant creator of the universe. And he's as large as the universe itself, says Jeremiah 23 verse 24. He's everywhere in the universe. And Earth is very tiny. This module, this maze is very high-tech. Everything we are doing is being recorded. And it is revealed throughout the Bible that our works will be taken into consideration because it's all being recorded. From every angle, we are being recorded 360. And even before the formation of our world, the Lord knows it. David used to wonder, how do you know? Even before the word is formed on my lip, you know it. He has a lot of information, friends. Don't try to deceive God. You are being photographed from all sides. What we think we are alone, I'm not alone at this time. From every side, apart from this YouTube video, I'm being recorded from everything. My own mouth, what I'm speaking, will work against me on the last day. The Bible talks about impartiality of God. Now I know why. Because we will be judging ourselves on the last day, our own acts and our own words. Let's see, where does it say God is impartial? I'll just read two or three so you understand. Let's read Deuteronomy 10 verse 17. Chapter 10 verse 17 of Deuteronomy. For the Lord your God, our God, is the God of gods and the Lord of lords, the great, the mighty, an awesome God who does not show partiality, nor does he take bribe. You won't be able to bribe him with anything. He is the whole universe. Peter says in Acts 10:34, Peter says, I most certainly understand now that God is not the one to show partiality. Because as they got the message, they realized it is us, our deeds, our words, which will condemn us or save us. What happened to sheep and the goats? Read it again and again. It's a judgment scene, scenario. It's a glimpse of what is happening in the future. It's an event waiting to happen. What happened? This is what happened. He's impartial. Whoever showed loving acts of loving compassion, whether it was the Good Samaritan who was of some other faith, who didn't know Jesus at all, but had loving compassion in his heart, and the Christ lifted him up. He captured the heart of Christ. That is what we have to do, guys. Turn away from sin. Turn to loving compassion. This was the walk. Carrying what? The cross of Jesus Christ. His righteousness. What does he say? Matthew 10 verse 38 and many other places in the Bible. Almost all the Gospels have this. Mark, Matthew, Luke and John. Pick up your cross. Deny your flesh. You have to live. I have to live a life of denial, not indulgence. If you want his heaven, if you want eternal life, if you want to be saved, you have to pick up your cross, deny your flesh and follow him. Because if you're going to sin, that's what you will get, the judgment. But if you practice loving compassion rather than sinning, you will get his heaven, was the message. Practice karuna, guys. I'll be repeating this word again and again. Get it in your heart, get it in your soul. If anything will save you, it is this. Because see, on the last day, he will pick up those who practice loving compassion, whether Christian or otherwise. He's not interested in labels. We are. He's not. He's going to see our works. What did they do? One more of this and then we'll move ahead. And Job says in 34:19, Job, who shows no partiality? God shows no partiality to princes, nor regards the rich above the poor. For they are all the works of his hands. So for God, everybody is equal. It is what we do which will matter on the last day. He is impartial. Again and again, I will tell you guys, it's your face. The man in the mirror will come out with a holographic image and stand in front of you. You will stand in front of you, your image. And I will be standing in front of me. Therefore, friends, hands folded, I beg you, practice loving compassion, practice generosity, practice kindness, practice righteousness. See, and that's why Jesus said, deny your flesh, because this flesh is very sinful. It will drag you into the womb of the grave. Sure, that is what it wants to do. And we have two other villains, enemies who hound us every day, the devil and the world. If you love the world, the love of God is not in you. That's a given. See, there are these principles. When God made this maze, and we have been put into that maze, because the sin entered the maze, the world, through Adam, our ancestor. Now, how do we beat this? Karuna. We move away from sin, deny our flesh. If you have to live like hermits, live. If you have to deny everything, do it. What does Jesus say? Cut off your limbs if need be and gouge your eyes. It's better to enter the kingdom of heaven without an eye or a limb than to enter hell with all things intact. What did he mean? No sin, don't sin. It doesn't mean cut off everything and throw away. No. He was very harsh on sin, like Father God. See, once you keep Paul out of the picture, you will see very clearly Jesus was talking exactly as Father God taught. What did they teach? Turn away from sin. Turn to what? Love. Kindness. That's the message. Okay, guys. Without wasting any more time on this point, or rather spending, not wasting, my apologies, we will see in the Bible, in the New Testament, and other places, how important it is to have works of kindness, compassion, because this is what's going to judge us on the last day, our own works. You got the message, you got the drift even now. I'm so glad to take this off my chest, so to speak, so that I may help you understand as I understood. We have to edify each other as iron sharpens iron, right? Don't go to the churches. They will teach you Paul will take you down into the shoal. Mr. Paul will take you to the shoal, surely, because he's a deceiver. And he says with his mouth, he's the one who taught saved by grace when Jesus didn't even mention grace. Did he forget? To millions he taught. Did the Son of God miss out? Oh man, I forgot. So he comes back after being resurrected. He could have said, oh, I forgot the first time. I should have taught these guys. See guys, you cannot obey the law. So what you do is you believe and you'll be saved by my grace. Now that I've died on the cross, my death is imputed to you. Does he say? No. What does he say? Gives the High Commission. What does he say? In the High Commission, just 28:18-20, Matthew. All authority has been given to me, so go and baptize all people in the name of Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all things I have taught, commanded. And truly I shall be with you till the end of the ages. Why didn't he teach grace? Why? He did not teach grace at all. Paul took advantage of Jesus' absence, physical absence. He was there in the spirit. And what did he? He twisted everything to suit his doctrine of deception. I call it DDD, devil's doctrine of deception. That's not going to help you guys. Grace is nothing. Grace will happen to those who have shown grace. This is a given. Write it down on your souls. Grace will happen on the last day to those who have shown grace. Be gracious. This is what Jesus was teaching us. Because you'll be shown grace. Doesn't it add up? And here you have a direct vision of the judgment. Nothing is hidden from you. It's very transparent. You watch it, the sheep and the goats. Think of yourself as one of them. What are you right now? Where do you want to be, friends? This is the end of this maze is coming to an end. It's ready to be destroyed now. This high-tech maze which records everything. And based on what we did, we will get our judgment on the last day, friends. This is getting destroyed. Coronavirus is from crown. What does corona mean? It's a Spanish word for what? Crown. It is from the crown. The judgment has begun. Began last year, 2020. And this will not end. It will take everything down now because he wants it down. This is a sin-infected module. This maze, this world, this earth is sin-infected. Now it's ready for judgment. Forecast when? Thousands of years back. This story was not written now. It was written 7,000 years. We are experiencing it now. When it was written, it will be destroyed and New Jerusalem will come down. Who will enter New Jerusalem? Those who practice loving compassion. Are you getting the scene, guys? I don't want to be harsh on you, but if I don't shake up and wake you up and myself, we will fall on the last day. We will yet again stumble once and for the last time. No chances after that. Today you have a chance. Very little, because this maze is going away. But yet you have a chance. Turn away from sin. Turn to loving compassion. Forgive everybody. Start loving people and others, animals, trees, everything. Become personification of love. And you will. Try, guys. Nobody taught you. How will you try? How will you learn if nobody teaches you? Let's go and examine where all it is written. So many I've collected these verses about we'll get what we gave to the world. Before I go into these verses which tell us that we'll be judged by what we did, let's quickly read what's written in Luke 8:17 about God understanding. Like, this is a maze and a module, high tech, where everything is being recorded. For there is nothing hidden that will not be disclosed. There's nothing hidden that will not be disclosed. And nothing concealed that will not be known or brought out into the open. Friends, this is just one, but there are many other places. It's in all Gospels. Matthew 10:26 says the same thing. For there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, and nothing hidden that will not be made known. Everything which we've done and spoken will come out in the open, light, so to speak, everything which we have done will be exposed in simple words, and we'll be very embarrassed for all the bad stuff we did, and there will be no death of Christ to cover, as Paul taught. On the contrary, it will judge us. So the safety zone of safety is practicing loving compassion. Why? Proverbs 10:12 says it very clearly, love covers all sin. Solomon knew it. His wisdom was from God. He knew it. It is, what is this love? Unconditional love. Unfailing kind of love. The agape, amazing love. Godly, pure, unconditional. This is not earthly love, which is conditional, selfish sometimes. This is pure love. Unconditional. Develop that. You are love. You've been made from love. Why? Because God is love. Where does it say? 1 John 4 verse 8. God is love. Whoever does not learn to love does not know God, for God is love, says John, Apostle John, 1 John 4 verse 8, and then he repeats 1 John 4 verse 16, for God is love. How many times is God called unfailing love in the Old Testament? At least 40 times, mostly in Psalms. By whom? David. David knew this guy is unfailing love. See, God's greatest attribute, amongst other things, is love. That's the Everest of His attribute. And whoever does not love, He is not going to accept on the last day, friends. This is what John was warning us in 1 John 4, verse 8. Alright? Now, let's see. Now, when I read out these verses, you will come to know that this is exactly what's going to happen. And the man in the mirror, the woman in the mirror, our own self will be judging us, like a holographic image will come out us, and we'll be and then we'll be shocked that how did this happen. That is what's going to happen. What we've done will be taken into account. So make sure you have good karma with you. That's what Christ is saying. And the greatest karma is love, the epitome, Mount Everest, according to Jesus, Matthew 22:37-40, and then Matthew 7:12, even to the teacher of the law, preceding the Good Samaritan story, when he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What did Jesus say? Love God, love your neighbor. Again and again and again and again, Jesus is talking about love, and we missed it all. Isn't this, in inverted commas, marvelous, fantastic? We did not see the elephant in the room of Bible's teaching was love. We didn't see, we didn't get it. Because of Pauline deception, and the churches are responsible for teaching Paul. They totally ignored and overlooked. Oh, I don't want to hear Jesus. Paul said, for all verses are, whether Jesus or Paul, everybody is in the Bible. Forgetting Jesus says, no server is greater than the master, and no messenger is greater than the one who sent him. Jesus says, I am greater than all. Solomon, everybody, he says, I am greater than all of them. Whether it was Solomon, or it was Moses, or it was Jonah, he said, I exceed everybody. He's God. He's the face of God. I and God are one. Right? John 10 verse 30. I and God are one. So he's the face of God. He's greater than all this Paul and company. Only Paul. Everybody is good. There was a deceiver. Like there was Satan in the Garden of Eden. Father God planted for his children, Adam and Eve. What was the snake doing? What was Satan doing? God uses evil to test who? Us. Let us not fall to evil then. Let us do what Christ said. Again, let us start. I want to focus on reading now quickly. How many times Jesus says about us getting judged according to what we did. Friends, we start with Matthew 7 verse 1 and 2. Jesus is saying, take this as a warning, friends. The time is over. The judgment has been initiated. Coronavirus has come. It's going to worsen. This is not going to go away. I'm sorry to say that, but or I'm glad to say that, because for all those who believe in the Lord, it's time for Him to come. But before He comes, all this will happen. The promised judgment is here. It's going to intensify. Now, judging others, Jesus warns us in Matthew 7, 1 and 2. Do not judge or you too will be judged. This is Jesus' warning. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And the measure you use, it will be measured up to you. What Jesus is warning us, friends, my apologies, is that do not judge. Turn to love again and again, friends, that's going to stand out. Learn to love, do not judge, lest you be judged. Because what you do is going to happen to you. How much clearer does it get than this warning? Are you going to sideline again what Jesus is taught, teaching, and run to Paul? Oh, somewhere he said, saved by grace, I'll follow that. But Jesus didn't teach grace. And this man says with his own mouth, 2 Corinthians 12 verse 16, that I am a deceiver who has come to deceive you. Now, coming back to Jesus, do not judge lest you be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. So use the measure of loving compassion, karuna. Use karuna, it will come back to you. It happened. Jesus taught and he did. See how marvelous he is. Excellent. Excellent teacher, excellent judge. He did what he taught. Where is it? Again, going back to Matthew 25, 31 to 46, goats and sheep. What does he do to the ones who practice loving compassion? Come on, my children. You deserve it. Here is your heaven. Because you learn to love. Sorry, I got emotional. All right, friends. Excuse me. See, the objective of this sermon, so to speak, or this message in the last days is a wake-up call, friends. I love you guys. It's in my heart and soul. I fear for people. That's why I'm teaching this. If I'm sounding harsh, strict, it's only because I love you guys. I want you to shake yourself out of this slumber, this stupor of saved by grace alone. It's not going to work, friends. You're going to fall flat, as predicted by the Lord himself. Those who want to teach Paul, ask them what happened on the sheep and goat judgment day. He just used the metric of loving compassion. He didn't care for anything else, Jesus Christ, the judge. He's going to come in fury, friends. It's no time for gentle Jesus anymore. It's finished, over. It's all in the past, gone, finished. What remains is his judgment now, and we have to face what we did. Alright, guys. Job 4, verse 8. Job 4, verse 8. Job is saying, even as I have seen, that's his life experience, Job is saying, they that plow iniquity and sow wickedness reap the same. He's saying, what you sow, you shall reap. This is what he has seen. What is called what goes around comes around. We have all experienced it. It's written in, and that is what's going to happen on the last day. And because of that, some will be condemned, and because of that, some will be saved. Same metric will be used. And again, I will say, sorry for being repetitive. I'm saying that because I love you. With folded hands, I beg you, practice loving compassion. Forgive everybody. Turn away from sin. Practice love. Now let's see what Jesus is warning us in Matthew 12, 36 to 38. Okay? But I tell you that everyone will have to give account on the day of judgment. This is exactly as it's going to happen, guys. This is the word of Messiah, words of Messiah. They cannot be changed. That's it. It's going to happen. What does he say? I'll repeat. Matthew 12, 36 to 38. But I tell you that everyone will have to give account on the day of judgment for every empty word they have spoken. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned. Now this is serious, guys. He's talking even of words now. Forget deeds we have seen. We'll sow what we've reaped. And the goats had to unfortunately be condemned. Because of what? Because they didn't have acts of loving kindness. Yeah, Jesus is even warning us that your words will condemn you. And because of that, the Lord gave me that face of that holographic image, that our own image will stand before us. So a holographic image of ourselves will come out, and it will judge us based on what we did. It's program. This is all program. God is neutral, impartial. We just read those verses. He does not judge. It is us, what we did. Jesus says in Matthew 3:10, see friends, I'm trying to connect the dots and I'm succeeding here. Grace of God, grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, which is using my mouth to teach you on these last days. Because it's a very difficult subject, guys. So much of deception has taken place to sweep it out on the last days is very difficult. But I'm trying to make sure you get the message. These are straight words of Jesus Christ. They cannot be denied. Everything is going to happen. They have happened since last 2000 years. Every word he has spoken has come good. And this will also happen, what he has predicted for the future. It's going to play out word for word. So please remember my words. Take heed and practice loving compassion. Acts of loving compassion. These are the fruits he's looking for. Turning away from sin. Fighting your desires. Fighting your sinfulness. I don't want to believe you. I don't want to do your stuff, guys. Flesh, tell yourself. Rebuke yourself. Fight your sinfulness. And do what? Pick up the cross of Christ, his righteousness, and follow him. Why did he fall on the way to the cross 3 times? The God of universe, so huge, trillions of miles long and unending, that he didn't have to, but because of his love for us, he fell on the floor again and again. It was symbolic of what we will have to go through. Same through carrying his cross, we will stumble, we will fall face on the soil, on the mud, on the dirt. You pick up, shed a few tears, but say, Lord, give me the strength, Holy Spirit, give me the strength to follow the Lord and his righteousness and fight my fleshly desires. When you do that and you practice loving compassion, what does Proverbs 10:12 say? All your sins are covered. The grace of Christ on the cross, the death of Christ on the cross is imputed to you. Are willing to pick up the cross, deny the flesh, follow him. Do you think the sheep did not fall once? Must have fallen 100 times. But because of Proverbs 10:12, because God is love, because they had acts of loving compassion, their sins were covered. The grace, and which were not covered, were covered by the grace of Jesus Christ's death on the cross. It is to these people. It is to these people that his death applies. That grace, so to speak, applies only to those who are willing to pick up their cross, deny their flesh, and follow the Lord. Getting the message, right? It's all there. I'm not making anything. I'm just quoting words after words after words from the Bible. So Matthew 3:10, Jesus says very clearly, the axe is already laid at the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into fire. It's all about works, friends. James said that, the brother, the earthly brother of Jesus, he knew Paul was deceiving. Read what he says in James 2 verse 20, that faith is dead without good works. He was shocked at what Paul was teaching. And I read this during my 5 years of research, that the Bible scholars of 19th century had caught this, that James had written as a rejoinder to what Paul was teaching. He was teaching nothing but heresy and blasphemy, that you have been saved by grace. So hopefully, friends, till now you understood this, and now we will go to the next section of reading more and more verses about how our words and our deeds on the last day will determine where we end up. Even by now, you've understood the message. I'm so glad that I could share it. It's a very difficult message, guys. This is not being taught and will not be taught, I think, for a long time till this. Please share it. Friends, let us read Revelation 22 verse 12, okay? Jesus is saying now, the judge is coming, he's almost here. What does he say in Revelation 22:12? Look, I'm coming soon, my reward is with me, and I will give to each person according to what you've done. He's giving you a clear warning, guys, and to me, right? Then Job 34:11, for according to a man's deeds, he repays him. God repays man according to his deeds. According to a man's ways, he brings consequences. So that's what's going to happen on Judgment Day, warns Jesus, that you will get what you have sown. That's about it. It's called the law of karma back in India. I didn't know for so many years as a Christian that this is exactly what Jesus was teaching, because nobody taught me. See, these are given laws. They are softwares. They don't care for who you are or what your name is or nationality is, what your faith is. It does not matter to that software. It just keeps recording what you've done and spits out based on that a reaction. It's a software. These are laws of God, universal laws. The Good Samaritan profited from it. He was not a Christian. He was saved. And many of these goats and sheep, they were also not Christians. He says, let all nations be gathered before me. Everybody. And whoever among you has loving compassion, I want that guy. I want this one. I want that one. I don't want this one who has practiced hate and practiced sin. He doesn't want them. Don't you get it, guys? It's all about what we decide. That's why we are free-willed. We have to make a choice. He hasn't made us into angels yet. We have to make a choice while we live on earth. What do we do? Whether we choose to sin, whether we choose to practice righteousness, compassion, kindness, generosity, they are like brothers and sisters, go hand in hand. And the tree of it is what? Love. These are the branches, these are the fruits, these are the leaves, kindness. Generosity, charity, compassion, they are all brothers and sisters and bound together by the love of God, who is love, right? Don't want to repeat the same thing. God is love. He expects us to be like Him. Jesus says in Matthew 7:21, not one of you will enter the kingdom of heaven unless you do the will of God. Matthew 7 verse 21. You cannot. What was His will? Love God. What is so hard to understand? It was very simple gospel of Christ Jesus. A simple message, so easy to understand, but got so hidden and obscured by the deception of Paul. And unfortunately, our churches chose to believe Paul. I've asked in one of my previous videos 21 questions about legitimacy of this Paul, who came by his own, by his own testimony. He didn't have any credible witnesses, nothing. A bunch of murderers who saw his conversion. What matters is what you choose to do now, today. Let your today be your day of birth, as if you came out of your womb, of your mother today, and you are making a choice right now. Turn away from. Repent for all you've done in the past. I should also, whatever I'm saying you, applies to me. As I teach you, I teach to my heart. Do it, Raj. Turn away from all sin. Say sorry. Fall on your face. Beg for mercy. Lord, forgive me, for I am a sinner. Teach me your ways that I may not sin against you. Teach me how to love. Fill me with compassion, Lord, that I may have compassion on other people. Help me turn away from all greed. I don't want a penny of anybody. I don't want to serve mammon. The demonic god of wealth is called mammon. It's in Matthew 6:24, and it comes from the original Greek scriptures, which use the word mammon. Some translations call it wealth. You cannot serve both God and wealth. It says very clearly, but let me read it out for you, friends. No one can serve two masters, says Jesus Christ, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and mammon. So who is this mammon? A demonic god, G-O-D with a small g, demonic god of wealth. See, the devil uses two demons on us every day. One is of lust. Why are we called carnal Christians? Every human is carnal by nature. And the other is greed, dollars and sex, so to speak. These are continuously, we are pounded with those thoughts. So Lord, pray to the Lord to turn us away from these two. These are the primary tools of the devil and the world to entice us into what? Taking us down into hell on the last day. Because they will produce what? Sinful acts. And what will those acts do? judge us on the last day. Our own face will look hideous to those who are living and getting buried in sin. It will be hideous, that face. So be careful, guys. On the flip side, on the other hand, the bright face, your own face will look bright like sun shining if you have love and compassion in your acts. That's the fruit Jesus was mentioning. All those fruits, all those trees which do not bear good fruit will be chopped. Even the vine and the branches, you know, I'm the vine, you are my branches, bear good fruit. Otherwise what? I will cut you, chop you out and throw it away and burn you on the last day. This is what's going to happen, guys. Again and again and again, the warnings are there. We didn't listen, many of us. I'm trying to fight my sin. I beg you to fight your sin. Pick up your cross. I will pick up. And let us follow the Lord Jesus, His righteousness. He did not sin at all in His lifespan. Let us try at least. And if we fall, we beg Him for forgiveness. What does He do? He's faithful to again. Is that right? But don't tell me I'm not going to try. Then you'll end up probably as the goat. I will end up like the goats who didn't try, who just had faith. And they were probably taught you've been saved by faith alone. They believed. It didn't work out. It flopped. And this is going to happen on the last day, friends. Okay, let's move to some other verses and then we will conclude. I'm going to read Isaiah 40 verse 10. Behold, the Lord God comes with might and His arm establishes His rule. His reward is with Him and His recompense accompanies Him. This is predicting Christ in Revelation, future times. Should I read again? Isaiah 40 10. Take it to your heart, friends. Behold, the Lord comes with might. His arm establishes His rule. Is Jesus coming to establish His rule, rule of righteousness. He does not want impurity. He doesn't want sin. He doesn't want hatefulness. He doesn't want judgment. He wants love and compassion. Again and again and again, I say one word for that is karuna. Keep that in your heart and mind and soul and practice it. Don't just believe in karuna. Practice it, guys. That's the fruit He's looking at. Behold, the Lord comes with His might and His arm establishes His rule. His reward is with Him and His recompense accompanies Him. I hope I'm pronouncing recompense. His reward, His justice is in His hands. Either way, He'll go either way. Goats and sheep. Isaiah 62:11. Behold, the Lord has proclaimed to the ends of the earth. Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your Savior has come. Look, His reward is with Him. And His recompense goes before Him. Guys, how many times should we be reminded? How many times will God tell us the same thing again and again? That we will get what we have given to the world. That's about it. As perfectly neutral and just as possible. And our own face delivering justice to us. And then Jesus will finally endorse that. He's not going to intercede. He doesn't say that. Matthew 25:31-46. Doesn't say that. He's not going to intercede for those who did not have any acts of loving compassion. They just waited, even Christians, that I believed in you, I did my bit, now save me. It's not going to happen. Sorry guys, it's not going to work out. Look at this, what he says in Jeremiah 17 verse 10 by the weeping prophet Jeremiah. They all had difficult time, they all suffered on earth. On the last day, friends, Jesus has told me, it's all in the Bible, there's going to be a big reversal of fortunes. All those, the first will be the last will be the first. Right? That's what's going to happen on the last day. That all those weeping prophets and all these Jeremiahs and all those Peter and Thomas, they all laid down their life. Jesus says, whoever loves their life will lose it. And all those who lose their life or are willing to lay down their life for me, are the ones who will keep it. Did anybody teach you that? No. They keep teaching you salvation, salvation, salvation. Jesus says if you love your life, you will lose it. Don't hanker. Don't pine and crave for salvation. Learn instead to love. Practice karuna. Only that will save you. So here he says, I don't want to drift too far and digress. And it's not digression. It's all interconnected and beautifully interconnected. And Again, friends, I'm trying to teach what has not been taught for the last 500 years, and through a capsule of 1 hour, it's very difficult to capture the whole gist of Bible. But the Lord was kind enough, He knew that all this will happen. He knew the story from word A, Genesis to Revelation, and it's all over, finished. He knew it. What did He teach? The entire message of Bible, lest we miss the point, was one word, Karuna. Loving compassion. That's it. It starts and ends there. God is love. What did He make? Love. What are we? Born out of love. Born for what? Practice loving compassion. Turn away from sin. Turn to what? Loving compassion. What happened when Adam and Eve did the first sin? It was not just an act of disobedience that they were driven out. That's the word God uses, that He drove them out of the Garden of Eden. They also had a choice to make now because of that fruit. They now knew the difference between good and evil. Till that time they did not. And after that, God could not keep them in His heaven. This is symbolic of heaven, Garden of Eden, because they had to make a conscious choice of what? Rejecting sin. And doing what? Following righteousness. Good and evil. They had to make a choice, which we have to. We've inherited those genes from our ancestor Adam and Eve. What again comes out? Karuna. Reject sin, practice karuna. As simple as that. That is what Christianity is all about, friends. Alright, let me read a few more, then we'll conclude this. Let's read Proverbs 11:27. Whoever seeks good finds favor, but evil comes to one who searches for it. So all the evil they will get is evil on the last day, and the ones who seek good will find favor on the last day. Proverbs 26:27. Whoever digs a pit will fall into it. If someone rolls a stone, it will roll back to him. So guys, it's again a software of law that you will get what you've given to the world. Why do I keep talking of karuna, loving compassion, again and again and again? 1 Peter 4:8 is similar to what Solomon says in Proverbs 10:12, that love covers a multitude of sin. He uses the word multitude, while Proverbs 10:12 says all sin. Again and again, that karuna will play out again and again and again till the judgment day occurs. And what is the judgment day? 25:31-46, Matthew. What is that? Future vision of judgment in goats and sheep. It is going to happen. Nobody can deny it. Even if we want to, it will still happen. What metric, what criteria did God use? He used love and compassion only. Nothing else was taken into consideration. People got back what they had given. That is the bottom line, alright? And whoever digs a pit will fall into it. And if someone rolls a stone, it will roll back on them. This is the law of God, universe. It cannot be changed, not for you, not for me. Whether we believe in grace, which Jesus did not teach, none of the teachers in Bible taught, nobody did, except one who was from the devil. I call it DDD, Devil's Doctrine of Deception. Grace and all. Psalm 7:16, the trouble they cause recoils on them. The trouble they cause, people will recoil on them. Their violence comes down on their head. Well, they're going to have a nasty ending, guys, the bad guys. They had their fun here. It's not going to work out on the last day, guys. Look what Jesus says in Luke 6:36-38. And I'm really encouraged not to keep sharing more and more. I will encourage, in fact, you to study the red-lettered words of Jesus Christ. I'm pointing you straight to the words of Christ. You will understand everything. He is the Son of God. He is the face of God. He is the Savior of mankind. We have to put Him above everybody, which we didn't for the last 500 years, possibly 2,000 years. And that is why this got obscured. And through an unknown person, a very average person like me, He is now revealing what He taught on the last day will be His expectation, and the metric, the criteria He will use to judge people and give them condemnation or salvation based on what they did. And that's why our Lord is perfectly just and impartial, because he will use what we did on the last day, what we spoke, what we did, what were our acts of loving compassion, whether they were there or not. And if they were, they will start killing all the sins we did. It's very beautiful. It's like water and fire. Water, cool water or cold water are the acts of loving compassion, and sin is that all-consuming fire, right? We'll consume our own life on the last day. Remember, friends, because I love you and I really love you, I mean that. And this love has grown because of the awareness that this is important. I need to learn this. I need to practice this. I need to have fruits of compassion. I keep few dollars in my dashboard. I see a poor guy. I thank him. Thank you. Thank you for coming to me here. It helps me practice loving compassion. Not that I want to earn my salvation. I don't wish to be saved. I wish to do the will of God. That is my one obsession. Lord, what is your will? Mark 3:35. Jesus says very clearly, who's my brother? Who's my sister? Who are my children? Whoever choose to do the will of God are my brothers and sisters and daughters and sons. He's making it abundantly clear. Unless you do the will of God, he doesn't want any relationship with us. Remember that, friends. And again, what is the will of God? Who taught us? Jesus Christ. What did he teach? Love God, love all people. Practice karuna. So you connect the dots. That is the will of God. Karuna, loving compassion. Look, friends, now let's read Luke 6, 36 to 38. And with that, I definitely will fold this up and with a lot of love also. Luke 6, 36 to 38. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Getting it now? This is Jesus speaking. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Otherwise, you'll not be. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. How much clearer does it get than this, friends? This is Jesus, crowning jewel of his teaching, is karuna. What is he saying there in Luke 6, 36, 38? Everywhere. The Revelation, Book of Revelation, same thing. My reward is in my hands. He's just doing exactly what Father God promised, what the prophet promised, and what the Son promised. There's no diversion, no divergence, nothing, no error, nothing. It is exactly what was spoken of, what was promised, is happening. And the one metric that will be used is, say with me loudly, is karuna, loving compassion. Where is that? Say with me, in the future vision of goats and sheep. Who's the judge there? Jesus is our judge. What does he do? He separates one person from the other based on what they did in their lifetime. And those who practiced karuna were the sheep who were saved, and those who did not practice karuna may have believed but did not have any acts of loving compassion. They were rejected. So friends, thank you for watching this. I appreciate you spending time, and I do hope and I pray to the Lord to bless your families and give you the wisdom and the desire to practice loving compassion, karuna. God bless you guys. Amen.